This is My Audiobooks, the world of audiobook library.
This is My Audiobooks, a novel, The Dark Lord, written by Nihar Sharma, narrated by Ambreesh Das. His Highness. There was a massive fire in hell. This wasn't normal. Both the soldiers and the gatekeepers were now angry with one another. The reason was simple. It was because of the cave that runs through the secret door, which if opened, will enable the gods to walk freely and kill them all. They were worried about the Dark Lord who had gone into a deep slumber. They had to protect their own lord. Demosus, a big, pig-faced giant who was the protector of the gate of the cave and the right hand and most trusted creature of the Dark Lord. It was a time to fear for deaths that are already dead. Existence will not prevail in both worlds. This alarming atmosphere has engulfed every corner of the netherworld. Rats that used to live in both the worlds have started running out of them. They had sensed death. But who was it that was coming to kill them? The only god who wanted to kill these creatures and souls was the son of the King of Gods. He felt a sense fun in suppressing all those rats down there and in capturing all the three worlds. He wanted to prove himself to his father and to the council that he was worthy of being a newly crowned king after his father's reign. But a single step towards the world of the Dark Lord could ruin his very existence. Most of the time, the Lord of all gods, the king himself, worried about his son. He was a god, but in the netherworld, he would possess the same power and skills as a normal human being. His Highness never listened to anyone, which meant creating problems for both him and the gods. For his protection, the king had deployed several heaven guards. There was no doubt that he was a brave warrior, but before the Dark Lord, he would be a child. This was also well known to him, but he wanted to go there and play his luck. He used to be extremely clever in theories of war. The king had underestimated his capabilities as he always treated him like a small child, but now the child god had all grown up. He already deployed a rat there for the purpose of spying. The rats could run into other world as they were the saviors to the natives of the netherworld. Rats were the only medium for communication with the human world, gathering information and news from that world. The Dark Lord allowed rats to commute seamlessly. Sometimes, he too travelled to the human world on rats. There was a small path, a connection between both worlds, and it was being used by the Dark Lord on most occasions. This small path was nothing but a rat hole beneath the oldest banyan tree, where people worship in the hope that their wishes would come true. For the same purpose, they also used to tie sacred threads around the tree. His Highness used to notice these things. The banyan tree was considered to be a half-god on earth, but was never treated well by the fellow gods. So the prince went there one day with a thread to tie around its trunk. The tree sensed His Highness. "My lord, you need not have come here. You could have ordered me to appear in front of you," spoke the tree. His Highness laughed. "My dear friend, if I commanded you to appear before me, then how could I request you?" "Yes, my lord, command as you deem fit. The slave is at your feet," said the tree. His Highness had nothing to do at this time other than to smile. He responded by placing a flower on the big root on the periphery of the outside of the banyan tree. "I need the key to unlock the secret door to Netherworld. I give you tonight to think and reply," and he left. The banyan tree was obliged. After all, the god himself offered him a flower. It was the happiest moment of his life. The banyan tree got a tad upset with the condition in the request made by the son of the King of Gods. It was the Dark Lord who used to fulfill the wishes of needy people who come here, and tie knots, and the Dark Lord never asked for anything in exchange. The Banyan Tree knew the Dark Lord to be non-indulgent in politics. He only enjoyed being here in this human world for a few hours before vanishing into the rat hole. But he loved to fulfill the wishes of all who come here with hopes. The tree was silent for a day, and in the interim, His Highness employed diplomatic schemes to dig out the secret door so he could lead his army through it and destroy their whole world. The time came and the secret door was unearthed. It lied beneath the banyan tree, and if it is to be reached, the tree had to be destroyed. His Highness gave him enough time to think, but the banyan tree had refused and showed its loyalty towards the Dark Lord. The spy rat appeared with the news that the Dark Lord was going for a long sleep, and during that period, the one in charge was Torian, the Dust Ghost, the most powerful ghost in the netherworld. His Highness now could take this chance to lead his army to that world when the mighty lord of the netherworld is asleep. The plan was quite impressive, and His Highness had coaxed his father into providing him thousands of heaven soldiers to lead a foray. The council denied permissions, but His Highness commanded his general to prepare his own regiment of 1,000 soldiers with 1,000 horses. An unnecessary war knocked on their door. The king wished to be the witness to the consequences. The old rivalry with the Dark Lord stood rekindled again. The king himself wanted to destroy his opponent's mighty world that he couldn't trespass in due to the truce. But his son could, since he wasn't bound by any pact. The Dark Lord himself knew about the secret door, which is why he always liked to fulfill the wishes of those who used to come to the banyan tree. Because of these people considered the tree to be holy, and the gods would notice it. It also meant that the secret of the secret door was kept safe. Except the Dark Lord, only two beings were aware of these facts: Torian, the shadow made of dust, and Demosus, the giant. Torian was invincible in the fire of hell and in the mighty blue fire of gods too. But the god's prince did not know this. The king wanted Torian destroyed first, but who would dare stand before him when he is a mere shadow made of dust? The Dark Lord might sometimes show mercy, but Torian, never. The heaven soldiers, under the leadership of His Highness, started marching towards the netherworld. The king lightened the sky and then torched the banyan tree, and the rat hole connected the cave of the netherworld with Heaven's Gate so that the army could march in. The secret door. The Heaven army already opened the gates of theirs and started marching towards the cave, the way to Netherworld. The Dark Lord was asleep and Torian was in charge. The Demosus was furious about his senses. He could sense the danger before it arrived. The secret door should not be opened. Demosus made his promise to himself to protect his master. The tree was torched. It wouldn't take more than an hour to turn down into ashes. Torian commanded nothing to stop that intrusion. The gods broke their truce, but Demosus couldn't negotiate with them as he was not in charge. Torian had to do something to stop them into the netherworld. Demosus ran to the chamber of his master, where he was sleeping for long. He bent down on his knees and started praying to his master. He was not afraid of his life. He was afraid of his master's life, who went deep slumber. Demosus muttered, "My lord, I know you have trust on Torian. He may be a mightier, but gods have more power than we have. You are our god, and anything happens to you will lead us to the darkness." Demosus then left for his chamber and prepared his armor and walked towards the gate to join others. He called his trustworthy leaders to prepare their armors and start gathering near the cave. The rats all had fled, but that spy rat was left to watch over them. While addressing his leaders, Demosu sensed its presence spying over them. He captured it and put it in a small bar. Prince God wanted information about the tactics of Netherworld Army. That is why he was waiting outside the gates for that spy rat's final report. The Heaven Army already surrounded that secret door, but there was a disadvantage. Only one by one could pass through that door because it was too small. Prince God had a great conviction to break that door, but had no idea he was going to face terrible consequences. This was not Earth, not Heaven. This was the land of Dark Lord. Even the King of Gods also stepped back, not to visit that place without his almighty weapon known as Bolt. It was against Truce visiting other world with a weapon. The Heaven Army's cheers had cracked through the door and heard in Netherworld. They were so close to the door. The Netherworld army was ready to answer God's audacity with blood, and the Demosus was leading them in this battle. Netherworld army tightened their grips on swords, bows, spears and shields and made a formation if the Heaven army broke into. The army outside the door was still waiting for the Prince God's permission. What was that stopping him to attack? The general of Heaven army had cooked up a plan. They had received the news about the door. The door couldn't be broken with weapons. They must require Heaven horses to pull out the door. It sounded pretty well as they had horses with them. Prince said, "Then do it. We have so many." The general looked at him and stammered, "My lord." "Now what is it? Tell me," Prince asked the general. "My lord, we will require 1,000 Heaven horses to pull out that door. But if one horse fails or falls down during the pull, the all 1,000 horses will die." "It's a curse, my lord," the general added. "What 1,000 horses? Do you have any idea? Those Heaven horses are much more precious than gems and gold. They breed in 100 years. They die in 1,000 years. And you want me to bet 1,000 horses on that door?" the prince shouted on general. After coming so long and putting all efforts together, he simply couldn't walk back just sake of 1,000 Heaven horses. The Dark Lord wouldn't be asleep forever. The prince didn't want to wait so long and miss this golden chance to prove his credentials to the Heaven. Rivalry. Vikram loved reading books, and one day in his father's cupboard, he discovered an old book named Devil's Heart, a novel where he read a chapter about Shanti Priya, the princess who wrote a letter to Veer in her own blood before the gladiator fight for Swayambhar ceremony, which dramatically attracted his mind too, to write a love letter to Sheetal to find her love forever. But he was afraid of blood. But one day, he managed to gather his all courage to write a love letter in his own blood and post it to her. She was impressed, and she was worried too. But Vikram had proved his promise of bond with her would be forever. The wind whistled their love story to the ears of Rajat, spread like a wildfire across the whole village. He had decided to teach Vikram his status. Rajat, on his bike, created a barrier to Sheetal to her home in the middle of the road. He couldn't control his anger and broke into arguments with her, while Vikram had come to know this and jumped into those arguments. Rajat, with the help of his friends, threw hands over Vikram and beat him on the road, while Sheetal was helplessly watching her Vikram to be beaten mercilessly. But interference from villagers had saved Vikram's life. Rajat left that place, but he would take his revenge back. He wouldn't let Vikram enjoy with Sheetal. She would be his and his forever. Vikram's action had impressed her more. She was impressed, but she started respecting him as he came for her safety. She couldn't resist herself hugging him. That was the best moment of his life. He literally wanted to kiss her in exchange, but he controlled his emotions. He thought it would be misbehavior if he had kissed her earlier in this newly born relationship. Everyone knew that Rajat wouldn't sit silent and he would be looking for next opportunity to finish his job, what he started with Vikram. While Vivek was his best friend and he was cleverer amongst them, and he suggested Rajat to wait till right moment appeared. Rajat was looking for the chance to feed his burnt heart with revenge, teach him and scare him so he could make distance from Sheetal. But he was proved wrong about Vikram. He had no idea that how deep their love was. Rajat was not holding any kind of peaceful mind and couldn't wait for the fair chance. He just wanted to bang Vikram badly so he could never stand in his way. Sheetal's denial and love with that poor boy had really hurt his ego and status. Ranjan was an imbecile and brute with his wife and used to fight with her and beat her when he was out of control and overdrunk. There was no place for Aaditya to have tranquility, so he used to sit next to that dry well. That day he went there for peace, away from his daily family fight. Vikram had missed him whole day, so he thought to meet him, but he wasn't home when he went his home. He knew that where would be Aaditya for fresh air. So he walked to him with slow steps. Aaditya was thinking something and missed the wolf near. Rajat passed near Vikram also, couldn't sense anyone. Then he heard sounds of screaming of Aaditya. Vikram rushed to him and saw him on ground Rajat, and his friends had been beating him with sticks and kicking him. And Aaditya was helpless and screaming in pain. Vikram screamed, "Aaditya!" And he jumped into the fight to rescue his friend, which cut loose and gave a chance to Aaditya to stand and fight back. He got his friends back. But Nandu stroked the blow on his head and knocked him down on the ground, and Vikram was alone now. The fight turned into a brutal ravage. Vivek could sense what was coming out of it, so he walked away slowly. And other two friends of Rajat's held Vikram tight, and Rajat was being heavy on Vikram with punches and kicks. Aaditya was on ground, weaker and exhausted. Vikram was helplessly watching Aaditya crawling on ground, trying to reach to his friend for help, but he was bleeding too much. It made Rajat little happier, but not completely. He waved Nandu to hold Vikram, and Satya Prakash would help him with Aaditya. Rajat took Aaditya with Satya Prakash and pushed him into that. He screamed, "Vikram!" The well is deep and dark. Vikram was stunned and got frozen, and his eyes were wide for a while. He could not understand what just happened with his friend. Friends of Rajat were also frozen with the fear, and Rajat fled from there in fear of being caught. They realized that they had committed crime and killed Aaditya. They left Vikram alone there. He had no choice except jumping into the well, so he jumped into the collision. The Heaven Army at their secret door and the Netherworld Army were in the cave at opposite side of the door to protect and hold it steady. Both sides were in fire for fight. Demosus commanded and screamed, "Hold it!" The face was so terrible that whole army gets scared of him. They were loyal to him and ready to fight for their home Netherworld. Since its inception, the gods, shadows, other tribes and human also attacked several times but always failed. But this time it was for secret door. All the battles were fought on open ground, but never inside the cave. Holding enemies in the cave was like burning own hands in boiling oil in hell's torture room. The Heaven Army was waiting outside with anxiety to finish the world beneath the earth and have control over everything. The spy rat didn't come yet, and the general looked at his prince and said, "My lord, we are running out of time." Prince understood the storm going inside the general's mind and the army too, but he was also feeling the same. If he failed, he might lose his chance forever. The eyes were burning in waiting for the door to be broken. The thousands heaven horses gathered in a parallel line, and the knob of the door was chained with it. Heaven horses could sense their deaths and they started protesting little. There was one horse less. They needed 1,000 horses. So Prince had given his favorite loyal horse, his friend named Dozer. It was gifted by his father when Prince was a kid. They shared the great bondage like brothers and friends. The prince used to spend time with Dozer whenever he was alone. The presence of Dozer in that line stops the resistance from other heaven horses. Demosus, with his netherworld army, was waiting at the point of the door. There was a fire in front of the door. Demosus never came here before, so he was a little confused with the size of the door. So he starts staring at the door. "Is it the secret door?" he muttered. The whole army was standing erect and silent, and then Torian from the fire appeared. Army cheered to see their mighty leader had come for their help. Torian, with a giant sword in his left hand and a whip in his right hand, his eyes was the balls of burning fire. All bent down on their knees and kept their right hands on their chests to salute their leader. His presence had lightened up their motivation. Demosus knelt down, "Lord Torian." He smiled at Demosus and said, "Well done. You prepared them well, my friend. Rise and hold the line stronger." He addressed his army. "This is our home, and nobody can take this from us. Not today, not tomorrow." The army cheered for him again. Before Demosus could ask him, Torian looked at the door and vanished through a hole in the middle of the door. "The great Torian," Demosus muttered and smiled. He raised the sword up and yelled, "Be ready, be strong, and be merciless tonight." The general went to the prince and sought for his command. The prince was a little emotional with his Dozer, but he had to do it for the welfare and future of the universe. The chain was tied and ready to pull the door, then Torian appeared. The first line of Heaven Army broke, and a blow on the face of General, an invisible man. Torian knew the Achilles heel of the 1,000 horses. He looked at the prince, and the prince looked at him. A shadow, Prince whispered, then it vanished. The curse was known to all. If the door opened, it will allow one at a time only. The door can shut if it senses any harm to any kind. The Dark Lord, who has the strength of 1,000 heaven horses, can open that door, and 1,000 heaven horses can open it also. Dozer wasn't afraid of any shadows. It was the bravest horse. General got up, and Heaven Army seemed little scared, but Prince motivated them. "Sooner we will break this door and destroy the world of savages and rotten." The army cheered. Torian had to do what he came for. He scared the last horse in the line and untied it from the line. That horse in fear ran away unnoticed. The general commanded, "Pull!" They had 999 horses. And this was not going to be possible to break that door now. The king was watching from above with curiosity, and the Dark Lord from his dream and smiled, "Torian. If they pulled the door with 999 horses, the all horses would die the black power of the door for its protection." With the command, soldiers lashed on horses and they pulled that door. The door sounded crack sounds, and all horses stopped before the door got broken. General and Prince couldn't understand why they all stopped in middle. Demosus with his army stepped back and held the line tight. They thought the door was broken, but not yet. The prince ran to his Dozer and saw it was bleeding from its nose. He looked at it with misted eyes and his heart was pounding hard. The Heaven Army looked stunned. What had gone wrong? Then a soldier came from back and reported to the general. "Sir, one horse had been released from the line." It shocked the general. Now it was clear why all the horses failed. The old magic had worked against them. Other horses were also bleeding to death slowly. The general looked at Prince and said, "My lord, we failed. Other horses are bleeding too." The prince could not control his rage and yelled on the general. We have done what is to be done, but the door is still not broken. The horses, a soldier screamed, the prince and general looked back. The one by one horse fell down on the ground dead. Dosa looked at prince and fell dead on the ground too. The prince couldn't control his emotions tight and yelled in pain. Then a voice of laughter penetrated through his ears. Army got prepared with spears and swords. A shadow, appearing to be in human shape, stood before the prince and smiled. The prince couldn't understand what to do with that bastard, and he had no idea about this one. Who was he? I never heard of it. Complete mystery to him. Arrest him! The general commanded his army, but he disappeared again in thin air. Demosus and his army were waiting inside for Torian to come back. He came through the same door's hole. Demosus asked, "My lord, what happened out there?" Torian smiled at him, consoled him to return with army and sleep well. The battle was over. The Netherworld army cheered in joy and all start marching back without Demosus' command. Torian again disappeared into the thin air and appeared before the prince. The angry prince captured him and took him to the Heaven Council to punish him. Torian smiled and muttered, "What a gift from son to father." Death embraced them. Vikram managed to drag Aaditya out of the well and breathed heavily. Aaditya was totally exhausted, but there was no wounds on his body after brutally beaten by Rajat and his friends. Both stood shocked to see they had no single bruises on their bodies. How could it be possible? Both had been into the well and came without any scars. The last thing they both remembered was screaming and breath-taking pain inside the well, the junkyard. "I knew it would happen," said Vikram in anger. "He started the fight," Aaditya argued. "Our lives. Have you gone mad? Look what happened. It could have taken our lives. Thank God we are alive." Vikram sighed and looked at his best friend and smiled. "But the good news is, we are still fine. See, there is no scars, bruises on our bodies." He calmed down Aaditya and both busted into a laughter. Aaditya asked, "What will we do now?" He came closer to Aaditya and touched his face. "Aaditya, we are fine and safe." He smiled and added, "Let's go home." "I don't know, maybe there was something inside the well." Aaditya looked at him. "Let's not try this again," Vikram snorted. Then promised to each others that neither they wouldn't tell anyone about this, nor they would look for vengeance, and they left their homes. Vikram found his parents were asleep, so he didn't disturb them, and he was exhausted, so without dinner, he went to his bed and slept. Where Aaditya was feeling little lighter and free. It was like he was tied up with something, but this world looked like he was in prison. Vikram also was unable to sleep as he was feeling quarantined in his own house. Someone suddenly knocked on the door and Vikram was awake, thought, who might be at this time? Then he heard some voices whispering, but it was too late by the time he got there. His parents had rushed outside, so he followed them. A lot of people had gathered near the well. He couldn't see anything because of people, and there was very critical ambience. He could hear his mother's cry and father's screaming. Then Aaditya appeared. They both were shocked and had no idea what was going on there. Why those people had gathered, and then Aditya's parents joined them. Priya and Ranjan broke into tears. Vikram looked at Aaditya completely surprised and seemed like the ground had moved from beneath off their feet. Aaditya held his hand tighter. Both were scared and in a cold wave shock. No idea why their parents were crying. Few people were holding the rope in their hands and pulling something out from that well. Both stepped forward. Vikram first touched his mother, but he could not touch her. Same with Aaditya. A cold ran down their spines. Their hearts became cold. They could not touch, except they could see them. Vikram and Aaditya tried to talk to them, but none was listening to them. Those people and their own parents couldn't see them, hear them. What is going on? They are not answering us. Nobody is talking to us and ignoring us like we never exist, Vikram screamed. Aaditya realized that they were no more in this world. He was also nervous and scared. He had never seen Vikram acting like this. Then the whole place was overtaken by screaming and weeping. They had pulled out the dead bodies. Vikram's and Aditya's parents rushed to their bodies and hugged them tight. And they were totally broken to see their children's dead bodies. Vikram sat on the ground next to his own dead body, but Aditya was with Vikram and kept his hand on his shoulder. He realized that they had lost their lives and now they were ghosts. They had witnessed their own death and their own bodies were on the ground before them. Their parents had broken into pieces and they were watching helplessly. They looked at each other's and promised they wouldn't let Rajat go unpunished. Heaven and Torian. Heaven had lost the battle under the prince's leadership and direction, and it would hamper him in future being a new king. The failure had made a home in his heart and was lost in grief of his horse's death, Tosa. He lost him because of Torian, and he would not spare him. The pain of seeing him alive kept hurting him all the way back to heaven. He wanted to slay him, but he was bound by rules and command of his father. Torian was brought to the king's court. He had to be delivered alive to the royal court for his sins to be judged and punished. The oldest enemies would meet again face to face. The lost battle had cost 1,000 precious horses and the morale of the army. The Dark Lord could feel his absence, but time was Torian's to play with gods. He was bound to certain limitations, but Torian was not. The king chuckled hard in the council to see Torian in chains. "Welcome to my world, my friend," Torian smiled back at the king. "Take and welcome him with our gratitude to great Torian." The prince ordered his guards to put him behind the bars. Torian smirked at his command and followed the guards to the prison. The general asked, "My lord, how can you put a shadow behind the bars?" The prince had no answers to the general, but he patted on his shoulder and replied with a smile which didn't reach to his eyes. "We captured him." The king wanted to visit Torian in the prison. He wanted to talk to him and make him feel that he was no any godly soul who could do whatever he wished to. This was the heaven, and here king's rule implied on all. "After a long time," Torian smiled, 5,000 years. The king smiled back and replied with harsh answer, "You are always a dog, and you know what in heaven we keep dogs behind the bars. I burnt you into ashes once, and again I will do the same," the king added. "Yet I am here," Torian made a sarcasm reminding king's failure. "I have a special arrangement for you," king smiled at him and turned and commanded his guards. "Keep this dog near the burning sun," and the king left and guards followed his order. Nothing could burn a shadow born from fire itself. King forgot this fact because his arrogant mind and old animosity had clouded the fact he used to know. His bar was kept hanged near the burning sun. The iron used in that bar was from the core of the comet, so those bars could endure the sun's mightiest power. The iron rods started turning into red, and Torian was standing in the middle of the bar. The king busted out in great laughter, seemed like he was having some kind relief in his heart and comfort over his wound called animosity. They left Torian there to be burnt before any trials in court. Torian kept staring at the sun with his big, wide opened eyes without blinking. Seemed like he wanted to see his real father who had given him birth out of fire. The origination of fire was from the sun god. He never had a chance to thank him but it was really very close and the best time to show his gratitude. He folded his hands and started chanting the shlokas for Sun God. The guards had checked after a while and found he was alive, so they informed the king. He was so furious to know that he was alive, and now he would stand for a trial in the court. So next day morning, they summoned the shadow. The prince is specially initiated to bring the prisoner to the court, and the general with prince walked to the courtroom. Torian, in chains, started moving to the royal court of heavens with the prince and the general, who was very loyal to prince. What kind of punishment they would sentence him when the mighty sun couldn't burn him? The general was worried about the security of heaven and their king due to fear of someone who was their prisoner, but his stories and accomplishments used to fear all, so general didn't want to take any chances. So he tightened the security of the chambers, council and personal security to king and prince. The guards of heaven door opened the giant door. Torian looked at the size of the door. The first question crossed in his mind, why that giant door was built for. He wanted to touch the door, but the guard from his behind hit him with the hilt of sword and pushed him forward. The king, sitting in the throne, smiled. He was happy to see his old enemy in chains. Soldiers hailed the king and all council members stood up and hailed their king. Torian was forced to bend on his knees. An old man in white loincloth and golden bar in his hand opened a letter and started reading. The man who is standing here in his grace's court is charged with deception, murder and betrayal to his king and all's king, and looked at him with narrowed eyes and continued, do you accept all these? The king to all, Torian commented sarcastically and laughed out loudly in that court. The general looked at one of his guards and waved his hand to make him quiet. He hit Torian with that spear on the ground to make him quiet. He grinned at guard, but a smile on guard's face seemed like he was not afraid of that so-called monster in chains. The guard hit him again. Torian didn't flinch for a while, but it made king happier for a moment. He looked back with his raged red eyes, which scared that guard, and he stepped back. He got upon his feet and looked around with his fiery red eyes. The council members got scared and the king stood up, and before he could utter, Torian shouted at the king, I have my king, the one and only Dark Lord. An old man announced, this is absolutely nefarious. He is embarrassing a king in front of us and we are quiet. He should be dead by stones. The king screamed, silence, I want to hear him. Please continue before you meet your destiny. And I promise you, nobody today onwards will rise against me, the king uttered and looked at his eyes. Torian laughed out loudly and his laughter echoed on the walls of the Heaven Council. Nobody can kill me, even gods. Folks, I'm here because I wanted to be. Then he disappeared and all started whispering and muttering in fear. The guard who hit twice Torian was dead on the ground and nobody could see this happen. The old man saw the guard's dead body, fled from the council in fear and hit with a pillar and fell down dead on the ground. The guards had surrounded king and the prince for their protections and other guards had started searching for him. The only god who was sitting calm and quiet in black cloak named Yamraj, he wanted to see the Torian, and here he had witnessed his capacity and power with his own eyes, so the stories were true about him so far. Then there was a statement on the top of the gate. Your reign ends. The general commanded to close the all gates of heaven and search every single chamber. The guards started searching for him. Then they heard a voice coming from King's chamber and they all rushed to there and on the top of the door of the chamber. The Scion is born, and he will be the real king of whole universe. A statement written. Directionless. They were stunned and frozen when had seen themselves dead. Villagers just fished their bodies out, and they were standing hapless and helpless, except but watching their parents crying over their deaths. We came out alive, didn't we? Vikram asked in broken voice, filled with deep sorrow and fear, tears in his eyes. But Aaditya had nothing to say. He was also going through the same. Aaditya sighed long and looked up in the sky and replied his friend. How does it matter now? Everything ended. We are now gone. I was the only son and hope to my parents. Their dreams died with me. Vikram scoffed and broke into tears. Aaditya had given his shoulder for moral support. Vikram used to stand with him same when they was alive. Now a puzzle started. When they had died, so what was left for them to stay back in this world? The whole world was now colorless for them. They could see something which they had never seen while alive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.